I wanted to talk a bit about the Sir Army Suit album, its artwork, and how it came to be. It's the third Klaatu album, and it's different than the first two. And that was our mandate, to make it different than the first two. We wanted to make every album different. We wanted to make every song different. We wanted to be in a state wherein we could do anything we fancied, do it well, hopefully, and not be pigeonholed into a particular genre. After the Hope album, we didn't want to be bookmarked as a symphonic rock progressive pop group. Nor did we want to be known as just a psychedelic band that records songs like Dr. Marvelo. If one of us brought in a really cool bossa nova tune, it was nice to know that it would be appreciated and looked at based on its merit, not the genre it's in or whatever. If we were going calypso, so be it. So the Sir Army Suit album is a collection of pop tunes intentionally set out to do, wherein we could garner some more radio play, certainly more than we'd captured on the first two albums. The Hope album in particular, although it's my personal favorite, is sadly lacking of radio-type hits. So Sir Army Suit was intended to do just that. Songs like Dear Christine, Everybody Took a Holiday, Tokey Moore Field too, are specifically aimed at radio. They're still done in a Klaatu-esque fashion, wherein they're a little overproduced, but that's what we did. Let me talk about the artwork a little bit. This is the third album, and it's the first one that Ted Jones didn't do. Ted had he was tardy and meticulous, and we were now living in a world of big industry record companies and serious mandates of deadlines and content, and they were sticking their nose in is what was happening. So we decided to come out of the closet, is the phrase I use sometimes. And so the Sir Army Suit cover has our likenesses on it. We got Hugh Syme to paint it, and it's loosely based on the song Holiday by Dee, where everybody's left the city and gone off to the country to have a holiday. Everybody's done it all at once. I have a copy right here of the vinyl, and you can see from the front here that everybody's going away toward the sun. This is Ted Jones. This is Hugh Syme, who actually painted the cover. I don't know who that is. And on the back, we are here. We're shown here as John, Terry, Dee, the Queen, yes, there she is, Terry Brown and his wife Linda, Frank Davies, and a multitude of people all heading off on holiday. So this was our attempt at revealing our identities. Further to that, we started doing radio interviews and these cartoons, these videos that you're about to see. The first one being Routine Day, we were all in it and rotoscoped in Hyde Park, and then magically transformed to London. Transmuted? No, what do they do on Star Trek? They teleported. That's the word I'm looking for. We were teleported to London, courtesy of Al Guest and Gene Matheson.
It started off a routine day. I got through the morning in the usual way. I caught the bus on time. Good morning, Mr. Driver, drive. As I sat inside my overcoat, I clutched my cane and pressed my nose against the foggy window. They know, honey, the life I lead would even make a dead man young. Midday comes, I break for lunch with my sandwich and a beer. I go on a hunch to the park where I hope to find a little bit of peace of mind. As I sat there on a bench amidst the road and race, I felt a strange sensation that without a trace appeared, but then as quickly disappeared again. with so much to lose, yet so little to gain. You sell your life away. Why can't you see you're just a cog working like a dog? You trade your future for a dead end job that's full.
John's going to talk about Routine Day. He modeled it after an artist that we both enjoyed during the early 70s, Gilbert O'Sullivan.
Yeah, I've always liked Gilbert O'Sullivan's work, particularly his first two hits, Alone Again Naturally and Claire. And he had a propensity to have run-on sentences in his lyrics, and his chords structures tended to meander, but they all made sense, and I really admired his writing skills. And Routine Day was really an attempt on my part to sort of, you know, come up with something similar to him.
And you got an A+, by the way.
Well, we both started on F6, so.
But it's one of those chord progressions where the bass sort of, it just keeps going chromatically down and down, and all the chords are changing on top of it and going in different directions. Really makes it really interesting, like Rainy Days and Mondays, that kind of sort of thing. It's really, it's my favorite song of John's, actually. And he's done some good stuff, but that one's my favorite. I'm a sap for that kind of stuff anyway.
And that song was written over a couple of years, too, because originally it had an intro to it. And it had a different title. It was called A Little Tired.
Really?
And, yeah, it was about waking.
We should re-record that.
Yeah, no, well, it wasn't that good. Anyway, it was about waking up and you had to go to work, but you didn't feel like going to work. And that was the intro to it. And then it sort of segued into this Routine Day thing. And then I realized that the Routine Day thing was a lot better than the opening. So I just canned the opening. And then I had to come up with a bridge, which came later. So it took, I think the very first crack I took at it was in June of 75, according to some of my tapes I have at home.
Wow, I'd like to hear that.
And I demoed it.
I promised not to put it on YouTube.
Yeah, it was demoed at Toronto Sound Studios in August of 77, just before Toronto Sound was shut down. So that's how it ended up on the Sir Army Suit album.
Yeah. Mm. And that was the first song that we used in this animation. Originally, we just did the one song, A Routine Day, and Capitol got it placed on Don Kirshner's Midnight Special, or whatever that thing was called, in the spring of 78, just after the, before the album had come out, 79?
79, I think.
79.
It was early 79.
So, because the album came out in August of 78, and then this animation was done, and was shown on Don Kirshner, which was a bit of a coup. There we are, the nameless, mysterious, hiding guys on TV, sort of, kind of. And that was interesting. I've been told it was the first rock animated video.
It started off a routine day. I got through the morning in the usual way. I caught the bus on time. Good morning, Mr. Driver, drive. As I sat inside my overcoat, I clutched my cane and pressed my nose against the foggy window pane. Oh, the life I lead would even make a dead man young. Midday comes, I break for lunch with my sandwich and the beer. I go on a hunch to the park where I hope to find a little bit of peace of mind. As I sat there on the bench amidst the rodent race, I felt a strange sensation that without a trace of fear, but then as quickly disappeared again. So tell me, what's the bloody point of playing?
Been back in ancient times, when people worked overtime all the time. In fact, it was in 1985. Life was busy in the big city, and the union was sitting pretty. It wasn't easy to stay alive, and they'd run from the city to the sun and the country and never quite get away. When the weekend came, everybody took a holiday. Everybody took a holiday. Yeah, when I wrote that song, it was way back. I was at the cottage on Lake Cashabog in Ontario. And guess what? I was on holiday. You never would have thunk, eh? Occurred to me that'd be really cool if everybody took a holiday all at the same time. Can you imagine if there were no trucks on the highway, no buses in the city, you know, no factories spewing pollution into the sky, and no planes, no nothing going on except everybody taking it easy? Wouldn't that just be great? I mean, the air would clear a little bit. Global warming would just have to take a back seat just for a few days. You know, when I recorded the song at the cottage of my four-track vocoder, I felt it could be interpreted for everyone, everywhere, to slow down just for a few days. Just take a look around you. Remember what life is really all about just for a minute. Well, I never realized how deep the lyrics are until now. What do you know? The next time you're feeling down, take the time to look around, listen to the song, watch the video, and then go back to work. Stop being so bloody lazy, you know? Let's get to work.
It happened back in ancient time, when people worked overtime all the time. In fact, it's 1985. Life was busy in the big city, and the union was sitting pretty. It wasn't easy to stay alive. And they'd run from the city to the sun and the country and never quite get away. When the weekend came, everybody took a holiday. Everybody took a holiday.
And what was the other one? Everybody Took a Holiday. Now, this is interesting. We revisited the film technique of rotoscoping, but this one we did in a, what do you call it?
Film studio?
Thank you. In a film studio. And it had one of those walls that melts into the floor, had no angle, so you got no perception.
There's no corner.
Yeah, no corner, no depth of perception and all that. And in that song, Everybody Took a Holiday, I was actually a baker. It's all these people working who decide to take a holiday and they never come back. So I was a baker and had to do that. And John was a window cleaner.
What's that?
You were cleaning windows outside on this nice Tudor house. And Dee was a delivery boy. He's got a cart with some boxes on it. And Terry Brown was in all these videos with us too. And in this particular video, he's a sculptor. He's the artiste, and we, of course, are the layman. And that was a nice piece of video too, because at the end of it, everybody's gone. There's no, because everybody took a holiday. You see, I'm going to show it to you.
It happened back in ancient time when people worked overtime, overtime. In fact, I think in 1985, life was busy in the big city. And the union was sitting pretty. It wasn't easy to stay alive. And they'd run from the city to the sun and the country and never quite get away. When the weekend came, everybody took a holiday. Everybody took a holiday. On a Sunday in July, everybody made up their minds. And when Monday rolled around, no one came home. All the cities and streets were bare. Everybody was having fun elsewhere. As the weeks went by, no one came home. And the stores closed down.
Toki Moore Fields is another one of my favorites of John's that's on Sir Army Suit. How did that one come about?
It's sort of like an exercise in psychedelic schmaltz.
That's a perfect description. I would have said that, but I didn't want to offend you.
Yeah, no. I mean, lyrically, it sort of has Peter Mac's pop art imagery. But musically, it actually was a nod to the Rascals, because I was a big fan of the Rascals. In 1967, they had about four top 10 hits, one of which was called With a Girl Like You. And I sort of, like many songs, when you're trying to get an idea, I just started fooling around trying to figure out what their song was. And then I started sort of
wandering
off and, yeah. and trying other ideas with it. And then the music for it is very similar in some ways to the Rascal writing that is in that tune. But musically, it is a little M.O.R. A little bit too M.O.R. for my liking in hindsight. But
well, we jazzed it up. The arrangement is still a little Klaatu-ish, not quite as psychedelic as it could have been, trying to go in both directions at once, schmaltz and psychedelia.
I think we overdid the dupes, though.
I'll take a listen.
Perpetual Motion Machine, one of the videos featured here, was really a lot of fun to do. The people who created it, they used a system called rotoscoping, where they actually filmed the band and Terry Brown walking around playing our parts for the video on a white room, white screen. Everything was white. Boy, tough to keep clean, I'll tell you. And then what they would do is they took the film, project it frame by frame, and the artist would draw or paint over each frame and create this fantastic illusion that is part real and part animation. And on top of that, what they did was they each frame, they would crossfade frame to frame, so it gives it that really spacey vibe that these videos have. It's wonderful that we're able to bring these to you finally after all these years. You know, not only that, but the music from that day so long ago, the fact that people still care, we still have people on the internet who care about Klaatu, it's absolutely amazing for us. We really, really are blessed. But just for now, I'm going to try to play this song a little better this time. Let's see. You can have your own very own perpetual motion machine.
How did it begin? It began as, for us, as our routine day, a call from a potential client to talk about producing an animated film rather than a commercial. So when we discussed it with the client, who turned out to be a lawyer representing Capitol Records, that was a really interesting project. When I came back and discussed it with you, I told you this was going to be a musical, an animated musical version of a song. We were quite interested, and when our quote was accepted, we got the job. then the band came over to meet us and to bring their song with them. Right? Is that the right way?
It was really interesting because there were very few music videos being done at that time. It was going on a TV station called, well, a program called Midnight Express, and Don Kirshner's Midnight Express, and none of us had ever watched it because it was a new thing and they were just videotaping bands and they weren't really, you know, doing anything special with it at the time. So this was sort of a challenge because it would be the first animated video. And we had never worked with a rock band before. And we were introduced to these guys and we really, really liked them. So we decided that we were just going to do everything that we could to make this really successful.
And it was good for us too because we had a reasonable budget. We had just finished a television series, so we didn't have to make a profit on it. And we said we'd just spend whatever we have to do it, as long as we could do it our way, that we could to come up with ideas, we could try stuff that we hadn't tried and weren't allowed to do in commercials. So we just, we did everything we could to make this a really good film. And it worked out quite well. Got it, it ran in L.A. and it was entered for Academy Award nomination. It ended up not bad.
Ran in Los Angeles, we came down for it because Capitol was putting it up for an Academy Award nomination. And we came down and we brought my mother down and the children. And it played in Westwood. And we didn't realize what it was playing with, you know. And then we found it was playing with Animal House, which was not really what we had intended to take my mother to. But it got a good reception with the audience, and it was really nice to see it with a college audience.
Now we had a commission. We met the guys. And we found out that we couldn't show them in the film, because they had developed quite a reputation. They had a pretty big following. Nobody knew who they were or what they looked like. So we were going to promote a terrific band, but we couldn't show them. So that became a creative problem. And we decided on various techniques that could sort of show them, but not actually. And that was a technical thing called rotoscoping. We shot them live action performing routines that we decided as part of our creativity for the film. And then we rotoscoped them and inked and painted and did it as conventional animation. So our problem was to interpret the song in an interesting, creative way that satisfied all the requirements of the content of the song, the need of the guys to look and to be in something that was pretty classy, and for us to do something that we would be proud of. So we had a lot of hard time over the storyboard, planning what the shots were, and how we were going to produce them. We have terrific enthusiasm from our staff and from the guys. I mean, they did anything we wanted when we were shooting them. And we ended up with a pretty good film.
Okay, I want to talk about the technology then. The technology then was rotoscoping. And rotoscoping was invented by Max Fleischer. And he developed a rotoscope machine, which was a 16-millimeter projector projecting on a 45-degree angle plane. That plane was rather difficult to keep tracing from for an animator. We subsequently, in our case, used an Oxbury animation stand, which was greatly superior because it also had registered pins. The registered pins meant that our 35 millimeter film would not move around, that the lines would not move around, that everything would be perfectly registered to each other. So when we traced it, everything was great, except that you do need an animator, even now, even through Photoroto, even through computer animation now, where they do rotoscoping through computers, you still need an animator, because the animator is the one that knows that if something suddenly appears behind a body when it's live action, because live action is not animation, that if that is a strange fold of somebody's clothing or something else, that whether to keep it or not is up to the animator to decide, because it can be strange little tumors, strange little objects that just all of a sudden appear for a few frames and then disappear. So animators are the final step to all rotoscoping then and now.
With the success of Routine Day, both in terms of people seeing it and our satisfaction with the production, we thought it would be really great if we could do a whole bunch of their songs and do a special. We thought television would be great for it, and more people would see it, and there's more money in it for production. We could do all kinds of stuff. So we went about to find investors, which we did. We had put together a bunch of guys who promised to put up money to produce this film. And the guys agreed, they wanted to do it, they gave us a bunch of songs, they came in, we did a lot of shooting to our storyboards, a lot of work that we planned, and we ended up with the makings of a very good special.
So the footage that you see will be the makings of the rough work on a special that unfortunately did not get fully funded. It got funded as far as we could go with our money, but it did not get fully funded because of other problems. Anyway, so there is some preliminary work, and the preliminary work you'll see is the equivalent of a scratch track that musicians do when they're trying to promote their music. So we hope that you enjoy that.
Yeah. Planet Earth, as you will see, or the sections of it, really had terrific potential to make a great show. But fate decreed otherwise, and just never saw the light of day. But you'll see some pretty good stuff from it, I think. Thank you.
Hi there, this is D. Long. I've been asked to speak a little bit about the recording of our album, Sir Army Suit, so many years ago. I'd like to talk a little bit about the gear that we used in the day. This was quite some time ago, and although everybody nowadays has a home recording studio, it was a special thing at the time to be able to have access to such a wonderful array of equipment. In fact, when we recorded the album, we started out recording using a mobile recording studio, a very large, very fancy truck with 24-track tape machine and an Eve console. It was a really gorgeous system, which we parked outside of Terry Brown's house. And we recorded some of the bed tracks, drums in the living room, using that truck. It was quite an experience. The rain at the beginning of Routine Day was actually Terry Brown's sprinkler spraying over his swimming pool. We used whatever we had to create the sounds and effects at the time that we wanted. Later on, Terry Draper and I spent quite a bit of time with that beautiful mobile recording truck outside Terry Draper's house, which is where the song Silly Boys was mostly created. That's when we took the 24-track of Heinous of Uranus, flipped it upside down, put it on the tape machine, and recorded tracks backwards to come up with a new song called Silly Boys. We were blessed in that, for example, one of the local music stores, a fellow used to drop by every evening or so with the latest bits of gear that had come into the store. One of my favorites was the Electro Harmonix Electric Mistress guitar pedal. It was a beauty. Combination of flanging and chorusing and EQ sweep to produce a really cool doubling effect, which you can hear on the rhythm guitar and Silly Boys. These days, a pedal like that is pretty much not available. They don't make them anymore, and it would be considered vintage. But at the time, it was the latest gizmo, and we had great fun using it. During those sessions, I also fell in love with another piece of gear that was on board that mobile recording studio. It was a great big unit in the corner with big metal heatsink fins on it, large levers, red and white levers with lights on them. It looked like something right out of Star Trek, the original. And it was one of my favorite units. It was the EMT-250 digital reverb system. You've got to understand, digital reverb is now the standard. Everybody who has a home studio would have a plug-in with digital reverb. Yeah, it's pretty standard stuff these days, but this was the first, one of the very first systems that was digital. Of course, we were used to using EMT plate, which was literally a great big sheet of metal in a box with microphones and pickups hooked up to it that when it was excited by your vocals or your drums or whatever you were recording, it created something similar to a reverb from a room. A very nice sounding unit, but this digital reverb was something new altogether. I remember that it had an infinite reverb setting, and I would crank this up and sit with the microphone and the headphones on and make weird noises into the mic, and just to hear this infinite reverb go on forever, it was really quite fascinating. It was an amazing unit. I'd never heard anything like it. You know, up to that point, we even used Echo Rooms. But when this digital reverb came along, it was really something special. Some of that album, Sir Army Suit, was recorded at Sounds Interchange. That was quite a time. I do recall that some evenings, I was there alone by myself, working to record, come up with new ideas, maybe come up with new songs. We'd book the time and the other guys weren't available for whatever reason. And I would be there all by myself in the middle of the night, recording version after version of Mr. Manson, most of which were pretty weird and completely pointless, but I had a great time. I was not really schooled as an engineer, and I was confronted with this solid-state Harrison console, a very complex recording system. It even took me a while just to figure out how to get a signal to the tape and back. But I managed to do that and had a lot of fun. And of course, most of what I recorded during those times had to be redone later when the rest of the band and Terry Brown were available. But it was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. I do recall one evening, very late in the evening, being at Sounds Interchange behind that Harrison console, and the phone rang. It was a friend who was a gear distributor for the kind of gear that we used a lot back in the day. He was a distributor, and he said, "I've just come from the airport where I picked up a Sennheiser vocoder, which was a $20,000 unit at the time, the very same type of unit used by Electric Light Orchestra, made famous by them, one of my favorite bands from the day." And he said, "I have this unit overnight. I don't have to deliver it to the owner until the morning. Would you like to have it overnight?" And I said, "Yes, no kidding." I pulled out the track of Silly Boys we were working on, and I did the vocoder vocals that you hear on the final version. If you listen closely, you'll hear some of the vocals are backwards, some of the vocals are vocoder. This very special, cool EQ effect that makes synthesizers talk and sing. What fun that was. We couldn't have afforded the $20,000, but I got to use this thing overnight. It was really great. When it came to mix the Sir Army Suit album, we again took the truck, the mobile recording truck, back to Terry Brown's house, parked it in the driveway, cranked it up. Terry was mixing. We were able to listen in the basement on his stereo system. We felt pretty blessed to have the support of the record company and the fans, to enough support to be able to do this kind of special system. We managed to create sounds, some very unique sounds on this album. When you listen to it, be careful to pick out some of the very unique, very different things we did back in the day when the gear that is now vintage was brand new. These days, I have thousands of plugins in my home recording studio on my Mac. If I was to replace each of those with the equivalent piece of hardware from the day, it would cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, which would be kind of ridiculous, because who can afford to spend that much money when you can get the same thing for thousands? Anyway, thank you for letting me vent about gear and the recording and the vintage sounds we used to get. Please, when you listen to the album, keep in mind that we were experimenting with the latest, even though now it may be vintage. Thanks very much for listening.
Oh, gosh. Well, it took a lot of work to make it, and on some of it we were working on our own, because Terry Brown was producing another band at the time, so we were trying to make all the decisions on our own, and some of which were good decisions, some of which weren't.
I know Dee and I were working together in the small room, as a rule, because we had this place booked around the clock, it seemed like, most of the time. And you and Terry Brown would work in the day on your tunes, and then Dee, I would assist Dee on his stuff. And there was a lot of experimentation going on, particularly on Dee's stuff. He was always looking for that sound that was just out of reach. And
I think the best example of that is Silly Boys, and I think there he did a really, really good job, because he was faced with a daunting task of having to take nothing but vocals and a click track that were backwards, and then rebuild, as it were, backfill a whole new musical arrangement around that. That would have been quite a daunting task.
I remember we recorded it here at Swamp Manor when I lived in the little shack, and we had the mobile truck out front, and the drums were set up, and we double-tracked the drums just to give it some depth and weirdness, but there was what I played to was Dee's guitar, the da-da, da-da-da, da-da, that kind of thing going on, and the click, and this backwards vocal going on. And so this is what I listened to this in headphones and trying to play the drums to it, and the second take, the double, was actually a little tighter.
Well, it turned out very well. I was quite impressed the first time I heard it.
It is an odd the song is as odd
as it gets.
As its birth, how it came about.
Right now if we wait for the opportunity, then we would see sun is reversing. Right now if we wait for the opportunity, then we would see the sun is reversing.
This song started with The Twisted Mind of John Wallace Chuck way back when we first recorded our first song, single as Klaatu, Anus of Uranus, and John went home, put the tape on backwards, and wrote down lyrics as he heard them. They were inspired by the backwards vocals. Surprisingly, the lyrics made a little bit of sense. In fact, the title of the album, Sir Army Suit, came from those backwards lyrics. No, we never got around to making a video of this one, which is a shame because it is easily one of my favorite Klaatu songs ever. But some years later, we took 2-inch master tape, put it on the tape machine backwards. We recorded some of the parts, kept some of the old parts, including some of the backwards lyrics, and created Silly Boys, one of the silliest songs ever created. Kind of interesting if you put the song on backwards, although it's hard to do with a CD these days, but you'd have to capture it as a WAV file, I guess, or an MP3. You can hear the original lyrics in some sections, and it's quite interesting. Drums were recorded twice to give it an extra weird twist, and, you know, I think probably out of all the songs ever recorded in history, there's very few that were ever recorded backwards, but that's, you know, that's just the way we think. Backwards.
I was going to talk about the Bat Cave. This is an experience that John and I shared when we were kids. And I mean, we were kids. I mean, we were in a band. The band was called The Trax, T-R-A-X. And it was 1966-ish.
No, I think you're right.
We were young, and I remember we played at the local church in the basement and different places in our junior high school and a variety, and some private parties where we get $5 each, and that would all go to rent Farrington an amp. But I digress here. What I was going to talk about was the Bat Cave. This was a place we played out on more than one occasion, which was on the third floor on Bay Street between Dundas and University on the north side. And the in this dank bar on the third floor, and I don't think they had a liquor license. They shouldn't have, because we were like 16 years old at the time. Or younger, and they had the Gotham City skyline with the bat signal painted on one wall, and there was stalactites hanging from the ceiling. Now, have I got that right? Are they stalactites or stalagmites? Help me out here, John.
I can't remember which one comes from the ceiling and which one comes from the floor.
That's my query, too. Anyway, the most interesting part of this little story is that we were so young and so close to the new City Hall, Nathan Phillips Square, that we would bring our ice skates with us, and between sets, we would run over to Nathan Phillips Square, put our skates on, and skate around on the little rink they had in the courtyard there. And then we'd make it back in time to play the next set of Jimmy Pitkin and Virgil Scott singing It's a Man's World. Or he would sing some other James Brown thing. We used to do I Feel Good, da 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 da, and a bunch of animal songs and stuff like that. But we were so young, we would go skating between sets. That's a dead giveaway.
How much did we get paid for this?
Oh, that was upscale. I think we got $35. So after we paid for the rental of the gear that we had to schlep up the three floors, we would actually make $3 or $4 each, which was a lot of money in 1966. Or so it seemed to us.
And we played there more than once.
Yeah, we did. We got invited back. We were actually pretty good for we weren't even a bar band. We were too young to be a bar band. What were we? We were Animals fans. One of the first songs we learned when John joined the Trax osmosed into the Trax from JP and the Five Good Reasons when John joined us. He had this Hohner organ, and we were playing all these Animals songs, and he had the solo to House of the Rising Sun dead. It was perfect. Right, just like the record, Pitkin used to say.
Exact.
And that was a big move for us. I mean, because, you know, there was a guy in the band now that could play his instrument.
Well, you never had a keyboard in the band.
No, we never had a keyboard player. So, I mean, you were shining big time right away. No competition.
It was news.
And you knew how to play. Yeah. That's a great story. I bet that place is gone, but not the building. The building's still there. It's right across the street from Lychee Gardens. And the place on the second floor was called the Chuck Wagon, which I think invokes visions of a country and western type atmosphere. Mm. But not the Batcave. We were right up there with the stalactites.
What was the origin of Mud Cow, and why the crazy name? Okay, so the answer to that question is that, as many of our fans will know, for many years, even decades, there has been rumors with respect to who we really were. And that sort of follows us around our career over the years. And I have to admit right now that it is true. We actually were Mud Cow. That was a band that predated Klaatu, but the connection is that the three members of Klaatu were all in Mud Cow. This is the artwork for a non-existent Mud Cow album that never happened, called Deep Trax. And you can see that what the Mud Cow is a mythical creature that is hard to describe. He was actually drawn by a friend of mine that lived in the same neighborhood as Terry and myself when we were teenagers. As far as the name is concerned, the best I've been able to put together is that it was sort of a play on words. I looked up a myth, some exotic creatures, one of which was a manatee, and it was described as a sea cow. And we wanted our creature to be a land creature, so we renamed it Mud Cow. So, not particularly brilliant or insightful, but there you have it. That is the history of Mud Cow, and hopefully it will end there.
We're getting ready to do these little interviews and video clips, so I went rooting through a couple of boxes of Klaatu memorabilia, just as John did, and found that really cool painting of Mud Cow. And I found this Klaatu Sir Army Suit postcard. It's got the front and back album cover, and on the back it says, "Ah, Sir Army Suit, you're psychic." And that's one of the lyrics from the backwards Anus of Uranus that appears on Silly Boys. And that's also where we took the title of the album from, if anybody wants to know. A lot of people have called it Sir Army Suite, which makes much more sense. But it's not. It's Sir Army Suit, and it's just this lyric from the backwards vocals that we came about and found. So that's kind of interesting. There's all sorts of this memorabilia kicking around in boxes in our houses that we've collected over the years. Some of it's kind of interesting, unlike this piece. Here's something you might want to see, though. We commissioned this guitar. A friend of mine, Milo Bojcic, made guitars way back when, and we got him to make this 12-string here, and he's put some gold music notes on it, and our name in the head, and gold, or abalone, I believe. And the nice part is that we got Ted Jones, before the guitar was lacquered, we got him to paint the sun on it. So this is a fully bona fide Klaatu 12-string guitar, and it needs tuning at the moment.
We actually had one incident at Toronto Sound Studios during the making of the first album. And I actually, at the time, I was not only recording there, but I was working there as an employee as well. And I remember during the day, the receptionist phoned me up in the studio control room and said, "John, you guys are working tonight, right?" And I said, "Yeah." And she said, "Well, somebody has called up and they want to have a tour of the studio. Is it okay if they do it while you're working?" I said, "Oh yeah, no problem. We're just going to be overdubbing some stuff tonight." So, and that was it. That was in the afternoon. And so nighttime came, we were working on our session, and we were actually recording something pretty weird. We had the tape playing backwards, and it was being played back at half speed, so it sounded like nuts. and I think it was Little Neutrino we were working on. And then the doorbell rang at the back there, and the light went on telling us that there was somebody at the door, and the engineer went to answer the door. And when he came back, in behind him came, there was these pair of lips that were unmistakably Mick Jagger's. And it turned out to be Mick Jagger. So he sat in and was very polite and patient, didn't interrupt us. He let us get on with whatever we were doing. And then every time there was a break in the action, he'd ask a question about the gear of the studio and, you know, what kind of equipment they had, the echo unit and whatnot. But that was a pretty interesting moment. And I can guarantee you that nobody said a word until he left.
I have another interesting anecdote. It comes post the Sir Army Suit album. We were in Los Angeles recording the Endangered Species album, and as was our wont, we would take breaks and go and play ping pong or pinball in the recreation room / kitchenette that the studio provided. And we were in there one day playing pinball, and the studio manager had Dolly Parton in tow and was giving her a tour of the place, showing her the various studios and the complex, the offices, and of course the kitchenette where we were playing pinball. And much to our surprise, we got introduced to Dolly, and she said, "Can I play with y'all?" And of course we said yes, and we all fished out our quarters and played a round of pinball with Dolly Parton. And the irony is that it was her own machine. It was the Dolly Parton pinball machine. And it was remarkable. It was extraordinary to be playing with this icon of country music on a game of pinball, like we were just friends, and it was her own machine. One of the things that happened to us when we were recording our Endangered Species album, which is the album after Sir Army Suit, was we had to stay in Los Angeles to record that, and we were recording at a studio down there called Sound Lab. And it was the month of December 1979 when most of the recording was being done. And so we worked on a daily basis, like working like a 5-day week. And one day we went to the studio, and it was the kind of studio where you had to ring the bell so they would let you in. It was all secure and everything. And we walked in there, and as we walked, we had to file by all the offices and everything. And that was normal. We had to file by all the employees to get to the studio. And when we did that, all of a sudden everybody in the room stood up and started cheering and applauding, and we weren't quite, we were looking around to see what's going on here, and we didn't realize what it was about until a few seconds later, because every time we went into a different room they would stand up and applaud, and they're looking at us as if we did something. Of course we hadn't. And then it clicked that what they were applauding was the day before the American hostages had been smuggled out of Iran by the Canadian embassy, and our ambassador, Ken Taylor, had actually orchestrated the whole event. So it was sort of their way of saying thank you to Canada. And I have to confess that was one of the most touching moments I can recall in our career.